The political year has ended with one of the most serious accusations you could make, that the Prime Minister broke the law. Joining me is former Federal Treasurer Peter Costello and former New South Wales Labor Treasurer Michael Costa. Michael, have the Liberals made the case?
I don't think so, and I think that Brandis has gone way too far with his accusation. Look, the bottom line with this is that there's certainly questions that need to be answered and questions that haven't been answered, but to make the stretch and call the Prime Minister a criminal, I think, is going way too far.
I thought it went way too far too. This is a case that was always going to be spoiled by going too far, wasn't it? I mean, there is something
What is the case here? To me, this has not really been about whether someone did a technical offence. To me, this is about a few things. One, what was this fund for? In my view, it's clear that it was basically to go to employers and to extort money from them on the grounds of industrial peace. Was that right or was that wrong? Secondly, what did she think about it? She said it was okay because it was a slush fund. And everyone has a slush fund, of course, don't they? Thirdly, when she was confronted with these allegations, how open and transparent was she about it? Now, leave aside this issue of an offence. I mean, you've got to ask the questions of character here. Was she open? Was she upfront with the client at the time? Was she protecting the interests of union members? Did she show any interest as to how this money was being raised? All of those things come together for a picture, I think, of union corruption that she was at the heart of. Now, that, to my way of thinking, is what this issue is all about.
But when you say at the heart of, you're not saying that she was involved in the corruption or had knowledge of it.
Well, she facilitated the association which was the recipient of the money. The other thing I thought was very interesting, nobody commented on during the week, was that when she was asked where she got the rules from, this is Julia Gillard, she said, I had the rules of the Socialist Forum on my folder, which I'd also incorporated. Now, up until now, when she's been asked about the Socialist Forum, which is the Communist Party, she said, I was just the tea lady. I was just working in the office.
Now, she just did the clerical work as a student.
And now it appears, no, she'd actually been at the heart of that as well, incorporating that, and she happened to have it on her file. She happened to be able to use it. I mean, there's a pattern here that she has not been entirely honest about her dealings, and actually she's being caught up with.
This is more of the issue, I think, isn't it, Michael? It is how Julia Gillard sometimes deals with these things too. There is, I think, a pattern of deceit, deception or deliberate misleading, and we saw that this week.
Look, I don't know whether it's deceit or deception, but clearly she would have been better off being upfront about all of the details of what occurred and kill the issue. Now, what's happened politically? Let's leave aside the questions of alleged criminality. What's happened politically? The government's gone into the recess without its political agenda on the table. We have these questions hanging over into next year, and that's a real negative for her. I mean, Tony Abbott's in a good position. Let's face it, politically, the Labor Party's...
You think that because it seemed like he was knocked sideways a bit.
But look at it. The Labor Party's grand policies, the National Disability Scheme, the education, they're all off the agenda. What are we talking about? We're talking about whether Julia Gillard's honest or not honest. The polls are still in favour of Tony Abbott. So clearly, from a tactical point of view, the Labor Party is in difficulty. And the decision on Israel this week, I mean, clearly shows even her authority is being undermined.
I want to get onto that. One last thing. You yesterday were calling for an inquiry into how unions were managed and the laws pertaining to that. Do you think such an inquiry should include the AWU scandal?
No. I think that those matters are best dealt with by the police. And in fact, there is police activity in that. What we need to do, Bud, is to give confidence to union members, these are public funds, that their organisations are regulated properly. Bill Shorten put some changes to the Fair Work Act in place. I don't think they go far enough. They're good, but they don't go far enough. We need an independent body to regulate unions. I don't think Fair Work Australia is the organisation to do that. To set the groundwork for that, I think you need a judicial inquiry or an inquiry of some sort to set the parameters for how they should be regulated. No less than company standards is what I would argue
for. Let me just make one point there. I mean, it's all very well and say, the police should investigate. The police have been trying to investigate. Let me ask another question. Does a Prime Minister owe an obligation to cooperate with a police inquiry?
Absolutely. absolutely.
You know, this is another issue that's going on here. Gillard keeps on saying, well, where's the letter? You know, you can't produce the letter. Some people might think that she should produce the letter. Or maybe she should actually go into the parliament and say what she said in the letter. You get this idea all the way through this policy of non-cooperation, you know, when a detail finally emerges against everything we've tried to stop, you know, there's another explanation, and then you peg off against the opposition going too far.
Well, it was like we saw this week, you know, first that thing, you know, had you talked to the WA Corporate Affairs Commission, where's your evidence?
Here's the evidence.
Well, that doesn't say
what it should have said. Well, what did it say? Oh, well, that's up to you to prove.
It doesn't inspire confidence.
It doesn't.
Listen, you mentioned the Israel vote. What was overshadowed? Julia Gillard was rolled by her party, led by Bob Carr, she actually brought in to help her, over the decision to give the Palestinian Authority observer status at the UN. Now, obviously, it says a lot about her leadership. I'm struck by how many reporters have been briefed to be told that one of the determining factors, Michael, was the Muslim vote in some seats in Western Sydney held by Labor. They're worried about votes as high as 20 and 23%. Is this the way that we determine foreign policy today?
Well, it shouldn't be. And I say to
you... But was it?
I think obviously it was. I mean, and there's no shame about that. They're actually actively saying that's the basis for the decision. But go back a bit. I mean, Julia Gillard was right about this, and I find it extraordinary that my former boss Bob Carr led a charge against a prime minister in the way it was. I have no problem with Bob Carr saying, "Look, Prime Minister, you're wrong," privately, and convincing her. But to ring around cabinet colleagues, to ring around caucus members, to put pressure on the Prime Minister, I think was quite extraordinary. And no amount of spin afterwards is going to change the facts.
Is he after a job?
No, I don't think that's the case. But I think it's a humiliating position to put the Prime Minister in. It was badly handled. And she's also got to take some responsibility. She should have understood those pressures at the caucus level.
Yeah, but to have so many people cravenly say the Muslim vote in our seats, we've got to change it.
But that's the democracy.
We've got to snub America, throw Israel under the bus, and do something that Hamas this week declared was a victory.
Well, I was on the National Security Committee of Cabinet for 12 years when we took some big decisions. We put an international force into East Timor to support autonomy there. We went to war in Iraq. We went to war in Afghanistan. I think I can say to you, nobody ever came into the cabinet and said, look, I've done an analysis of how many East Timorese there are in key seats, so we better put a force into East Timor. Nobody came in and said, you know, I've done an analysis of how many Afghans there are before we go into Kabul. Foreign affairs is one of these things that you decide on the national interest and what's right. And I think that, you know, you've seen this week domestic political considerations start determining the national interest in foreign affairs. I think that's extremely regrettable. And I think Carr's got a lot of explaining to do here. Bob Carr is the man who set up Labor Friends of Israel, right? So I'm a Labor friend of Israel right up until the point that we have more Lebanese Muslims in the country, in which case I become the Labor friend of Lebanese Muslims when it comes to voting in the UN. Now Carr was shoehorned into this job because he was the shining light. And I've got to say to you, he's brought the grubbiest domestic political outlook from the New South Wales Parliament to actually make foreign affairs decisions.
And he wouldn't have tolerated his own cabinet process as being run in the same way, and I think that's the issue. Look, let's be realistic.
Well, I don't know, Michael. I mean, it wasn't a great government, with all due respect.
I'll debate that with you some other time. But the bottom line is with this, but we don't need to be purist about this. I mean, the fact of the matter is the right position was the one that Julia Gillard had. Domestic politics does impact on governments,
the bottom line, this craven extent, that's the issue.
That's the issue.
Votes in the UN are decided by local political.
I'm agreeing with you, but no, the issue here is that she should have been aware of that. She should have had at least advisors.
That's right.
I agree with you, but
we've got to go.
That was the other interesting thing.
Peter Costello, Michael Costa. Shame we don't have more time.